Or maybe they want to come, not singing. Just raise your hand to God and be silent. Just be silent before God.
Have an opportunity to just dance and blow the trumpet and go
them rationally in thinking. This program organized by our brother, and friend, is for our spiritual development, so that we can expand and become vessels in the hands of God. So that even when we go into the realm of sin, the word of God will draw us back and say, come back to me and change. Our Christian faith in Nigeria is becoming bastardized because it does not affect in tandem actually the quality of life to me. May it not be so for you in Jesus' name. That has been said, the topic of today is hold on to your belief. Say to somebody, hold on to your belief. And that is taken from Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23 through 24. Hold on to your belief. Hebrews 10, 23 through 24. Let us hold on firmly to the hope we profess, because we can trust God. Let us be concerned for one another. Please, follow me. Let us hold on firmly to the faith we profess, because we can trust God to keep us to keep his promise. Let us be concerned for one another, to help one another, to show love and to do good. The gospel. Now, it will be very good for us to know what prompted that statement. That's verse 23 and 24. We must know in the first instance that the letter of Hebrew was not written by Paul, but it followed the style of the writing of Paul. And it was written, it can be called a priestly letter. A priestly letter. Because in the letter of Hebrew, we emphasize the priestly state. And having that priestly state and priestly understanding, he goes to uplift the people at the heaven of that time to the celestial presence of God. Remember, it is the letter to the Hebrew that supports the writer said, you have come to the world, Messiah, the city of the living God. We are millions and millions of angels have gathered for the festival, and all of us have first bronze, and we wear our first garments. You can see the elevation. So it is a theologically loaded letter that has emphasis in touching the heart of men to discover Christ the High Priest. So the essence of the letter is about discovering Christ the High Priest. And then try to make a comparison between the priesthood of God and the priesthood of Christ. And then the altruistic sacrifice that Christ has came to give us, which was prefigured in the Old Testament, and the actualization of it in the New. And then emphasize that we don't need animal sacrifices anymore, for they have nothing to do with salvation. And which means everyone now anchors faith in the one who died on the cross. That was the essence of what the writer was trying to portray. So that Christians who believe in Jesus that died on the cross, we have firm foundation, firm belief in him, and it will be an unshakable understanding of the glory of Jesus upon their life. Amen.
Amen.
So let me do a little kind of analysis or definition of, so that we can look. What does it mean to hold? To hold is to grasp, to carry, or to support with someone's hands, to grasp, to make the natural self friendly, to carry, and let it keep its mind. So you have that confidence that what you are holding belongs to you, or something you are holding for another person, or somebody supporting you to do something. So the whole thing is to grasp. To give or detain something or someone, to keep or detain. So when the Paul or the writer, sorry, the writer said, hold, we are talking about grasp, sustain it, firmly, do not allow it to slip out of you. Are we there? Do not allow it to slip out of you. Nobody should take it away from you. Which means that which you hold must be a costly thing. Somebody say costly. Must be something costly. Something quite expensive that you don't need to throw away. It's something you have come to discover that this is so dear to you, you cannot relinquish it anyhow. And you will not allow that to be contaminated by anyone. You hold it tenaciously, grasping it, carrying it with dignity, the word. Now, as a verb, now, as a noun, an art or manner of grasping something, a grip. Somebody comes to grip you by force. Put me and hold you as if we are holding a criminal. Power or control can also be seen as holding. And in that way, it means we have come to the acknowledgement that this cannot just be out of me. Believe. What is belief? An acceptance that something exists or is true. An acceptance that something exists and is true, whether it is seen or not seen. We believe in God, that God exists. Have you seen God before?
No.
But we see God each day through one another. Is it not true? But you believe. It's something unseen, invisible, in the realm of the celestial powers, that we believe that God is alive. And we see his movements and activities every day. And it is your belief, your faith that is keeping you going. So in that way, you have that confidence that what you believe is real, even when you are not seeing. The reason why all of us gather here today is because we believe God is alive and God is seeing it. Is it not true? But have you seen God? You have seen God, look at it. How can you believe in a consecrated bread that is the body of Christ? I was watching when Jesus was coming. We were all praying, standing good. So a person can kneel and discover that the Lord is passing and the reverence is through their own adoration. So that we don't lose sight of the magnitude of the presence of Jesus in the Eucharist. Are you with me? So that our senses and our experience of worship should not take away from us that Jesus is in our midst. The Lord is here. Don't you embrace him here? How do you believe that Father Ben laying hands and consecrating bread must say, consecrating, because the body of Christ? And you say, it's Jesus. Are you believe? And somebody says, I don't believe, not Jesus. So it's something you have confidence across. You have that belief in that. That attitude, that manner of worship and request towards that, whether it is seen or not seen, you have that belief. Something you have trust and faith or confidence in. You can believe in your wife, you can believe in your husband. That's why somebody can come and say, you Father, did this? Say, no, I know you can't do it. Because of what? You have confidence. You believe that there are certain things you can do and there are certain things you cannot do. Somebody brings a report to you about their children in school. No, my son cannot do that. You swear with everything. Because you know the level of training and the level of acceptance of the training that you are giving to them. And when you ask, is it true? My son, no. I know what he can do. My son can lie. If you steal, he will not steal. You have that kind of understanding, believe. There's a level at which you have known that person. But unfortunately, there can be, this thing can be corrupted. That's where the Bible has said, hold on. Hold on means stick to that purity of understanding and belief, because it can be corrupted. People can bastardize that concept of your belief and change your understanding of it in the negative. Therefore, hold on to what you have, which means hold on to pure faith, pure understanding, pure teaching of the church. What God has handed over to you, don't allow anybody to corrupt you. Hold it in because it is precious, it is godly, it is something unique, it is something you love. Hold on to it, nobody should destroy that kind of concept, the belief that you have. So your belief system of everyone who believes in Christ must be something that opens us to love God more. Amen.
Yeah.
That is what the church is talking. Beholding unto our belief does not necessarily mean that we practice what we believe. Does this sound contradictory? I want you to follow me. You can hold on to your belief that you don't practice what you do. That is where we have false claim. False what? Yes. See those people. Not from the point of view that you make mistakes, no. Or point of view that you fall and fall. But from the point of view that which you think you believe, you are not even putting it into practice. You can be holding on to your belief, but you are not putting it into practice. Because of the manner of life and the things you do. We believe in God, He exists. And we believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. We believe. But why do people leave God and go to do other things? Because their practical dimension of that belief is not put into action. It's lacking. We hear stories of people who believe in God, who go to church, but they didn't have chance. Is it not? Is it not true? They go to native doctors. Many people who say, I believe in God, they go to church, but they belong to secret societies. They will even plan against this program, and it should not work. They can be somewhere be doing their own manipulation and incantations against the work of God, but that means to go to church. Do they believe? Do they actually believe? Are they holding on to their belief? They don't know because why? They just set it on the leaves. Why they are not treating the action? So this gathering is not just about holding on to belief, but it's about holding on to what you believe and putting it towards action. And that is why I said that the entire church here can put the entire group on fire, can put the entire department on fire, can put in my one market area on fire. Because we're just here in the spirit, you know? Now, after the program, we go to your shop to cheat people. And you come back the next day to God, to Jesus Christ. What you believe, are you putting it into practice? Then you begin to see that something is wrong. There is a crack. There's somebody that is a crack. Again? In the belief system, that belief system there's a crack because it is not uplifting you to a holistic submission of faith to God. Am I too fast? Are you following me? So, the holistic submission of faith to God. That is the problem I have. I don't know how to make it. I don't forget about it. Anyway, I go and say it. It gives me concern. The quality of Christian faith and the quality of Christian we are raising today. Are we really following the rules of the apostles? Who we are raising to that? Let me to go into that. Even holding on to faith. What Jesus said at the last day to us holding on to faith. So, my dear friends, very, very important that we should look into this so that our understanding of holding on to what you believe is about making it to be more practical. More what? Christianity is not in words and theory. Christianity is not a word. It is a word. Practice. It is a word. And that is what should be our content of it. Blessed are those who hear the word of God at work. Not those who hear the word. They do hear the word of God at work. Blessed are they. Blessed one that Mary heard the word and acted upon the word. She held on to her faith and belief. That prompted her to visit Elizabeth and enter into the hill country of Judea and enter the house of Zachariah. It was an action. It was an action. Not that the word came to her alone and she kept it. She acted upon the word. The word. The word took her to a visitation. And that is what we call, in a Catholic understanding of Eucharistic adoration, the first Eucharistic procession. The first Eucharistic word was done by Blessed Virgin Mary. The first Eucharistic procession. Because he made a procession to the house of Zachariah carrying wood. And that is procession. And that's what we do was. When we go on Eucharistic procession, we carry Jesus and say the word is our Lord. And when the baby in the womb of Elizabeth, the greeting of who?
Mary.
God said the child in the womb did what? Because there was an action. There was what? An action. An action became an action. Take it. Say an action became an action.
An action became an action.
Good. A good act begets a good act. Even though it is not acknowledged by people, God calls for it at the appointed time. Because you know that you are open to the life of grace. So my dear brothers and sisters, this is a night for us to learn more about voting to faith or hold on to what you believe. What proves the exercise of our voting, the exercise of our voting to what you believe, is not the reading of scripture, it's not the preaching of the word of God, but it is in the keeping of the word of God. This is where the writer of the letter to the Hebrew emphasizes. Jesus is the living word. I want to bring out now three things that you have to hold. Why the writer said, hold on to faith. Number one, Jesus is the living word of God. He is the one that leads us into the presence of God. The living one that leads us into the presence of God. We're going to read that chapter 10 very well. We will discover this. And it is within this that you say, hold on to that, the agreement in your belief. That Jesus is the only one that leads us into the presence of God. That's the God. And that to say, every one of us now gathered here today, for us to hold on to faith, we must hold who? Jesus. And holding Jesus said, submitting to him, align ourselves to his worship, and say, Lord, lead me. And he will lead us into the presence of God. And leading us into the presence of God implies abiding with God. So when we say, I hold on to my faith, and I'm not allowing Jesus to lead me, something is wrong. Something is what? Wrong. My that belief is deficient. My belief is deficient. It is not coherent the way God wants it to be. So the first challenge we need that confronts us this evening is to allow Jesus to do what? To lead us into the presence of God. That was the writer was telling the people of Hebrew, the Hebrew church. And allowing Jesus to lead us into the presence of God means we have chosen him to be our leader. Our what? Our leader. Which means no other one should lead me. No other person should lead me except Jesus. And that is why Christianity is not a religion of people who just gather together, but of those who have made a pact with the Lord and said, lead me, I will follow. What do you mean? It's not a congregation of people. It's about those who congregate here, but have made a decision that you have to lead us and we are going to follow you. And you are leading us into the presence of God so that we can have the divine aroma of his presence. The glory of God coming upon our life. We can experience it. Remember that in leading the people of Israel out of the land of Egypt, there was the killing of what? Killing of what? Not only the first one, killing of what? Lamb. Is it not? And the blood was used and placed on the lintel. Is it not? It has to do with flesh and blood. Flesh and what? For them to depart. And he said, when I see the blood, I will pass what? And that was a sign of their being led, the blood of animal. So in the new dispensation, Jesus did something remarkable to tell all that he is the one leading. And what did he do? He gave his own flesh, his body to be what? Crucified. So the flesh, the blood of Jesus, nullifies every other sacrifice. So in the leading and we following Jesus, no other is therefore necessary, except the sacrifice for power. And that is why, my dear friends, we pity those who come before the Lord and offer other words, sacrifices. We are not to condemn them. We need to help them to understand that those sacrifices have no power over them anymore. I remember some years ago, a young lady came to me at the university and said, "Father, my mother said she'll see me." I said, "So you are here based on your mother's faith. So it can grow you up." And now, in the course of my discussions with me, the way the Lord talks to his priest, something just ministered to me. A sacrifice was made on her head. And so as she was narrating this story, as she used to go here in the dream and all that, and I asked her, "Was there any sacrifice made on your head?" Because the deep ministration was coming up. And she said, "No." I said, "Were you taken to somewhere and a sacrifice made on your head?" She said, "No, Father, we are captive. I've never gone." And I said, "Look at you." She said, "Believe me, look at what I got about you. And this was done by your mother." So when I said, "Oh, Father, yes. We were taken to a particular church. And at the back of the church, there was a kind of a shrine in a church. Openly, it looked like war. Then at the back, like war. And where they used one black cloth to cover her. And the mother brought a goat with the sacrifice so that the demon had taken her with him. You see how people plunge themselves into higher problems as a result of ignorance of the word of God. Amen? Amen. So, going into the presence of God is so leading us. Means there's no other sacrifice anymore. Tell somebody, there's no other sacrifice.
There's no other sacrifice.
Again?
There's no other sacrifice.
There's no other sacrifice. We need no other sacrifice. Greater than the sacrifice of Calvary. So, when we talk about Lord, we want to hold on to faith. You hold on to faith because He is leading you and there's no other sacrifice. So if you have been going to other places and making other sacrifices to anything at all, to any power, anywhere at all, any smallest sacrifice made, Jesus said today, "I love you. Come back. There is no other sacrifice than my blood, than my own." And that will give you away from the forces of the world. And his life should the life live because we are no more of the old. We are no more of the old. We are the new because we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. As the rending of the tabernacle veil opened the way to God, the tabernacle veil that was broken, opened. So also the rending of the flesh of Christ revealed the full greatness of his love. Full greatness of what? His love for humanity. And the tabernacle veil was open. So also the rending of his flesh revealed the fullness of his love for humanity. And victory was given. That is what we are celebrating. That is the love we're talking about. That is what we make us to be close to the Master. Another thing, second point, for those who are writing. You know that in the program, there are those who don't just study, they just want to just watch and go. Do what? Watch and go. Even if they can write, they just want to be like that. No, don't be that kind of Catholic. We are training generation of Catholics who can defend their faith. Who can stand for them? Not the Catholic who just come and just like that. No, you have to go deeper and be able to have something that will aid you for life. They are told that the word of God is going in and they are sleeping. But the moment they hear, "Oh, what are you doing?" When the world is not finding a place in you, who are you going to? The life we need is the life of the world. The life of what? The world. What gives victory is the word of God. Don't confuse it with anything. The Bible says that the word of God is the word, a lamp, not the word, a feet. That it has the power and capacity to make distinction between both and what? Matter. It has power. It is what will ignite in you the desire for the kingdom and propel you all the way to do that which is pleasing to God. God, it has power. When you don't have anything, even when you are challenged, even when you are in difficulty, it's the word of God that gives you inner peace that nobody can offer to you. True or false? That's why we need the word. When we need that word, it empowers us. Number 2 point, as we hold on to faith, what was told the church, the Hebrew church? Jesus is the high priest over God's house. Is the word? Over God's house. Jesus is the high priest over God's house. And faith is the high priest over God's house. Every other priesthood is under him. Is what? And which means he controls all the kingdoms of the world. So if you hold on to faith in Christ, what you believe, it means you are on a higher pedestal of spiritual superiority. Spiritual what? You cannot be afraid of these elemental powers and forces. But today, many of us tremble because of minute forces. And we misuse the sacramental even in trying to do those things. Yesterday, at the greet that when we had CWO probation meeting, a young woman followed me after the mass in the auxiliary mission coming back to Kotako. And she was telling me an experience of someone trying to expel evil spirits. Trying to expel evil spirits within the colonies. Had the lighted 20 candles everywhere. Are you getting me? Every corner, the lighted candle. And brought incense at every candle, every corner of the building that they are casting what? It was because demons will be. And this is a Catholic. And he thought that by burning 20 candles, the devil will go what? And then bring them. I said, no. Say, those people need catechesis. Now, the woman told me, Father, is he why you should teach us well? We need understanding before we go astray. Can the burning of incense cast out demon when you are living a life that attracts the demon? Ha ha ha. Hello?
Hi.
Hello?
Hi.
Don't think I'm here to give you what you think. The word of God is to follow us. And tell us to do what is right. Amen.
Amen.
I'm not here for entertainment. Here to tell you what makes you to understand what we are and what we should do. If you think that burning incense that will expel demons is a lie, they cannot expel the demons unless we live the life that attracts heaven. Hello? When we expel the demons because of the way we live, they will not come anymore. Because when our life attracts the demons and we are casting them out, it becomes a lot of contradiction. Where will the demon go to? When you are living a life that attracts the demon to come in. Are you with me? So when we acknowledge Jesus as the high priest, he is the one that will dismantle the stronghold and the power and the kingdom that try to impede our progress as children of God. They will be dismantled by him alone. That is why we hold on to faith, acknowledging Jesus as the high priest of God. And when Jesus acknowledged that high priest in the house of God and we submit to him, he began to deal with those things that afflict our life, that causes problems in our spiritual life. Jesus began to cool them down. Those imaginations. What St. Paul told the church of Ephesus, Ephesians chapter 6, begin to talk about cooling down imaginations, not fighting flesh and blood, the spiritual power. Flesh and blood is not only about demons. Flesh and blood, they are fighting. It's also the things, imaginations in us, activities in us, characters in us, that does not glorify God, they should be pulled down. It is in pulling down those things that we have opportunity to impress God. It is in pulling down those things that we can hold on to our faith, what we believe in, the creed we profess, because those things are no more having power over our life. It is such a situation that we can present a sweet smelling offering to God that is acceptable to God as children of God. It is within that context that we can speak authoritatively God's word and the demons begin to bow. If no, there is nothing we can achieve. The demons will be happy that we are committing things. The demons will be happy that we are glorifying God and living in iniquity. But the moment we change and say, God, I know I'm a sinner. I return to you. I want to make amends. We take this program, change my life, change my attitude. I want to have an encounter with you. You begin to see that the climate will begin to change. And the moment the climate begins to change. The spiritual covering begins to come. The glory of God descends upon you. You begin to see Jesus as the high priest. The devil will run away from you. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
The devil will run. Nobody will tell the devil to leave. The moment you step into the territory where the kingdoms of darkness are, as a child of God, they will see the land upon you and begin to give way. Say, a child of God has come. We cannot remain here anymore. Somebody say, anymore.
Anymore.
Again.
Anymore.
They will leave. They will not stay here anymore. Because you carry the light of Christ. You carry the glory of Christ. You carry the power of God. You carry the favor of God. Those things that people do just upon you, you will not. Because the grace of God comes upon you. Even in your vulnerability and frailty of life, grace of God covers you. And the grace of the power of God comes to dominate and control your life. You begin to see things from a different perspective. Because you are holding on to faith and you are contacting with Jesus as the high priest, then everything is conquered by the power of God in your life. You are not going to be intimidated by any power. Somebody comes to me and says to you, you see, this year you shall die. He said, thank you. If you are not my friend, I will not die. Amen.
Amen.
Say, thank you, I will not die. I will do what? Because you have the authority of God upon your life. Because you are holding on to what you believe in. That Jesus is the high priest who controls you, who controls your life, who controls everything about you, who knows you in and out, or who you cannot hide anything from. Then you have the authority of a child of God. You have the power of a child of God. You walk freely. Righteousness, peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. Is it not? Righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. Can we sing it now?
Righteousness.
Again.
That is the kingdom of God.
Don't you wanna be
part of the kingdom?
Don't you wanna be
part of the kingdom?
Don't you wanna be
part of the kingdom? Come on, everybody.
Don't you wanna be part of the kingdom? Don't you wanna be
part of the kingdom?
Don't you wanna be a part of the kingdom?
Come on, everybody.
The moment we open up to God, every other kingdom will bow. Even when that kingdom will be trying to fall, they will not come to get you back because you are on a higher pedestal and for those job, speed, power. They will not come near to you. Because you are an instrument of God. You have got to discover the high priest. Then you hold on to that. You confess that. You profess it. The enemy has no right. Tell you what, the enemy has no right.
The enemy has no right.
Over my life.
Because I have Jesus
as my high priest.
And
because you have Jesus as your high priest means he intercedes for you. He intercedes for me. Imagine you have Jesus as your high priest, which priest again can control you? See why we should hold on to our belief. Hold on to it. Wonderful topic. Hold on to belief. If Jesus is there, and somebody comes to my market and say, oh no, this is a market to go, that's a statement. But I believe I have one who is in my market to do what my business will do what? Who is mine. So nobody will intimidate you. Nobody will make you to be a threat. You remember they take your name to them, say, no, you see this person, please, take his word back. He is not of this kingdom. There was a story of a young lady that was kidnapped in Washington State some years ago. And they carried her through the back into a narrow road where they kept other guests. And so when they reached that place, they brought her out and they entered a particular house and saw other young ladies died. And that is where they killed them and used them for sacrifice. This young lady didn't know what happened to her. And the moment they took her in front of the juju priest, who has the power to say, kill this one, the man started shouting. Where did he bring this one from? Where did he bring this one from? Take it away. You want the wrong thing to go now? The guy didn't say a word. Didn't say what? All the guys were lying there, they were there. But the moment she appeared, take her. She should not be here. You want our business to spoil? And they started begging the guy to leave. May God be with you.
Yeah.
May you discover the power of a child of God.
Yeah.
Don't be afraid. Nobody should intimidate you if you hold on to faith. Hello? I want you of you. Why can't you not be afraid? Somebody say you will die, you say you have that. Come on! Tell the person I believe. Where I belong is high. I'm not under any power. You begin to control them. Don't be intimidated. Don't be carried away by any power. You are more than any power. That's why Jesus said, you are more than conquerors through the world of the fall. He said, though they will come in one direction, they will scatter in many ways. So the glory of God will be upon you because you're holding on to faith. Don't allow yourself to be spiritually intimidated. You are a child of God. Washed clean by the blood of the Lamb. Not the blood of animal. And Jesus is the high priest in the sacrifice. Give Jesus a clap of praise. Hello. Number one is what? Jesus is the lily way into the presence of who? God.
No.
Number two, Jesus is the high priest over God's heart. Over God's what?
Heart.
Number three, Jesus is the one person who can really cleanse us. The only one person who can really do what? Hold that. On the top, even if you have fallen several times, Jesus will come to you and say, my son, my daughter, do what?
Right.
He's not saying, I'm a king. Because he said he came to save and not to call them. But we should not take the grace of God for granted. Because he forgives us, we begin to fall every time. Even when we fall and return. But do not fall and remain there. Jesus is saying to you, come on! I am the only one that can cleanse you. And he is the one that you require us. That is why we should hold on to faith. Now, as this word of God is standing now to you, can you just discover within your body chemistry those things you have done, those that have brought impurities into your life, that made you not to be a true child of God, that made you to jubilate even when you know you are walking in iniquity, that made you to begin to discover that, oh, my God is anything, but no, you are not living out of life of God. Can you begin to check them out and say, Father, I am sorry. Bless me, because I don't know what I can do. They don't know what I can purify. Even when my neighbors condemn me, even when people condemn me, they say, no, Lord, you cannot condemn me. I come to you. I want to be in communion with you. I want to experience you. Then the moment we do this, my dear friends, then the blood of God comes in. That blood, so powerful, more precious than anything, the blood of Jesus. Which pleads for us more insistently than the blood of heaven. That brought the cause of purification. So that we are no more condemned, but we are redeemed and saved by the blood of the Lamb. That is the way God has taken us to. And that is the level of spiritual assimilation that we should have as children of God. And the moment we are under the level of faith, oh God, we begin to fly. Take yourself, I will fly.
I will fly.
I will fly.
I will fly.
Because Jesus purifies me. Yes, you will fly because it's very fast. Nobody now can have the power to say you cannot fly. Not even the things I've committed. Not even what people say. Not even the bad news I'm telling these people give. Because you know, Jesus is there to purify me. And his purification is that I should enter into communion with him. Then I go on to that way. We are there men and women who head on to their faith. Until they believe. Yes! Even from Old Testament scripture, Daniel chapter 1. You have to go and read the book of Daniel from chapter 1. Shadrach, Meshach, and who?
Abednego.
And Daniel. They stole their land. They were taken captivity into Babylonian territory. And then before they do, they said, let us take men of wisdom from their land. Let us take them. And they took them. And not only that they took them into Babylonian captivity, they made them to be in the palace of the king. They found a place to be in the palace of the king. Which means they were a privilege than others. And they were given an order, do not pray. Do not do what? A king. And how can you disobey the king? I said, we will give you the food from this palace to eat. They wanted that. They said, no. We know your food. That's why I said, we want to eat only vegetables. We want to eat what? they hold on to their faith. Who want to eat vegetables? Do not pray, they hold on to their faith. They wait and be praying. Faith. And because of their insistence in their commitment to God, help responded. Help did what? The one who was against them now come to favor them. He said, the whole land of Babylon, all of you, my commander Paul, worship the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. For there is no other God than the God of Shadrach, and Abednego. The one who said, I will kill you. Do this now, come. May your enemies begin to speak good of you. May those who say you are going to be killed begin to announce their freedom. They stood their ground because they held on to their faith. What of Paul and Silas when they were put in prison? And this is all, why are we suffering? Because right now, prosperity gospel is killing Christianity. It destroys the foundation of our faith. There's the kind of mammonic worship that is taking over today in Christendom that you need to be very sharp. And that is a lot of issue of money. We need more here, but sometimes we need to be careful as children of God. It is, can be mammonic and a succession of mammon over Christ. And it can be taken place in different ways. The sister Lord, because we believe in you, everything will be good. Why was he going to prison to suffer? They saw suffering as part of their crucibles, part of their Christian faith. That even when they went to prison, instead of lamenting, they started taking praises to Paul and Silas. What must I do to be saved? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus is also in transforming lives. They didn't say die because they are God enough. Die because they are here. They pray. And God responded and saved them. Because of the, they are holding on the word. What do they believe? And God was there to fight their battle. May God fight their battle. May God defend that faith you are holding. When they cry, God will be able to command all their powers. And they will be able to express freedom. What of the Acts of Apostle chapter 12? When they killed James, the brother of John, and Herod, people were happy that he was killed. And then they came over to kill Peter again. The Bible says, the children of God gathered and went into a particular place to pray. You know? They entered and they were praying. They were holding on to their word. Faith. Jesus Christ, yes. They succeeded in killing them. If they kill the head of the church, something is happening. If the leader of the church that gets authority upon you, I will build my church and the gates of hell shall not work, prevail. I give you authority over power. If they hold him and kill him, we are strong. So when they went to pray, Peter was there. What happened? They were holding on to them. The scripture says, the angel of God comes. And say, you, yes, touch me. The chain for the world. May every chain for the you believe. Yeah. Now, what brought about the release? The word of God. The power according to God's word. They then conducted a prayer and prayed. How many of us are praying today in the churches? We are the prayer warriors today. No prayer warriors who only see evil. Your mama, grandmama, and the king. They don't give you this one. Family deliverance, pay this money. You go home and think of any business. So families have invited four prayer leaders to do the same thing at home. Not so. And they come back and say, what we need is Jesus. What we need is who? We can stay here that this night. And speak a word to whatever that is done to you that is an ancestral cause that is out of your family. You don't even need to stress. You just speak a word. What did they say to Jesus? He said, Lord, speak your word that my servant shall be
healed.
He said, I am not for a brother to come under my roof, but say it. So in the realm of the spirit, a force of God's gravity of words is not evident. It's not what? Nothing can stop it. Something that is real. You see the woman. And God begins to do this work. And you see the grace of God. He made manifest that the grace of God. And when they were there praying, Peter now said that he was negated. The angel was leading him. Until the angel led him to the what? The iron gate. And the iron gate opened by his side. Many gates. Every door. Walking in you. Attacking you. Something against your family. May they begin to open. Holiness and prayer that opens the door. Amen.
Amen.
Sometimes the way we shout this fire, sometimes just we have no faith. Fire is there, but we just the holiness and the fire of God. This begins to go. The moment there is a gate open, the Peter now that was in prison started walking majestically. Amen.
Amen.
Where we are those who heard him, there we are there. Where we are there, they were watching him and he walked majestically. And he went to where the apostles were praying. And when he went there, a young lady called that came and opened the door. The moment she saw Peter, she ran the back. And told him, Peter is saying, no, it's not Peter. It's his ghost. Those who were praying started laughing their prayer. Because of human weakness. Not knowing the how God can operate. Sometimes we limit the operation of God by our own limitation of understanding. Amen. Allow God to operate as God. Let God be God. Let God be God. Let all men be liars. You see, God is trying to defend the cause of his name. And the moment he narrated what happened to them, they didn't see that. They have a first day and they come again. Use your wisdom. Use your what? To be a Christian is not that you should be stupid. Can you hear me? It's not that you should be stupid. Because the presence of Peter at that time protected the church, guided the church. So that the church at the earliest beginning will not be neglected. And Jesus guided them. May God guard you.
Yeah.
I said, may God guard you.
Yeah.
May God establish you.
Yeah.
Open doors that cannot be closed anymore.
Yeah.
On the condition that we follow these principles of coming to Christ. Go and read in Matthew chapter 24. Matthew 24. From verse number 9 to 13 or 14. Go and look at the criteria of the children of God. Some of us are in this world, we are getting more confused. Look at what Jesus said that will happen to us. Who believe? And that is why the church of this time should rest those who should be ready for matter. Ready for what? If we proclaim only prosperity and prosperity as the world is doing now, when the time of persecution comes, we are even going to abandon Jesus because our hearts will be only on what we have acquired. But the church will prepare those who are ready to die for the kingdom. That's what goes on in the life. That is where we should be. Those who should be ready even to say, yes, God, I'm ready for you. Then you will be arrested. Yeah, go from the night. Can we read together? Number one, where to go? Many will give up their faith, and they will betray one another and hate one another. Then many false prophets will appear and fool many people. Such will be the spread of evil that many people's love will grow cold. We need something. Holding on to your belief. Can this what you say? These things we have. But today, we are not preaching the theology of something. No. But they are here to happen. They are bound to come. So look at what happened. Many people, their faith will run cold. Many will even abandon the world and begin worshippers of mammon. Do not allow yourself to be a worshipper of mammon. A worshiper of what?
Mammon.
Be very careful. Do not allow money to be the epicenter of your Christian life. It is destructive. It is called legal tender. It becomes legal because the government approved the people and it's just a paper. Is it not true? So don't try to destroy it. Hold on to that which is truly saying. Do not allow the material things of this world to be something that will occupy your mind. They will fade away. They have no lasting value. But we need them to promote the kingdom of God. We need to be generous to the things of God, like in this program. We need to be generous and do things that we promote the kingdom of God. But at the same time, be very careful that mammon will not uplift your mind. Is that okay? When we stand firm in God's word, we find the fulfillment of the children of God in everything we do. And then we find the joy that God gives. In that way, we hold on to the end. Many said persecution will come. There will be prayer. There will be what? So when somebody betrays you, do not be surprised. Do not be what? It is bound to come. When somebody